good to be in God's house this morning, and it's certainly good to see this. Amen. Amen. I hope you had a blessed week. It's good that you're here today. We welcome you in the church and outside. We would like to also extend a special welcome if you're a visitor. We hope you feel at home here at New Hope Baptist Church. So at this time, we'll all stand and we'll sing a congregational song. We'll do page 120 in the church hymnal. Victory in Jesus. Couple of cards I need to read. This one says, there are people in our lives who are so genuinely kind-hearted, and it says to our church family, thank you for all the prayers, calls, and food. I love all my church family, could not make it through any problems without you, from Delane Crow. Thank you, Delane. And I'm not sure if this one's been read or not, but the joy of the Lord is your strength, from Nehemiah 8:10. And this one is from the Ben Clausen family. And it says, thank you for all your prayers and the love offering. Our family has been through so much over the past couple of months, and we greatly appreciate everything that you have done for us. Ben has come a long way since November the 8th of 2020. It was touch and go for months. And if I can say anything about our faith, it is that something like this will test it to the breaking point. But with all the prayers lifted up to our family, up to God, he brought Ben, me, and our family through it. I honestly don't know what I would have done without it and for all of you praying. Then after we got home on January the 6th, 2021, about a week after Ben, Shelby, Clayton, and Michaela all got COVID. So I'm not sure how I managed to get through it. God brought Clayton and the girls through it with just minor cold symptoms. Ben did not have any symptoms as of Friday, the 29th of 21. They were all well and negative. We did not know how many people knew us got sick. They weren't aware that many people knew that they had the COVID. The outpouring of love from everyone, from phone calls to letters to social media, coworkers, was pleasantly overwhelming. We can never thank you enough for what you did. I pray God blesses each of you. It's amazing what God's people can do when all of us come together with love, the Ben Clausen family. So remember that. We want to make just a few quick announcements that next week we will be taking a special offering for Amanda Carnes to help her with her traveling and living expenses while she's gone on with this medical situation that's going on with her. I think she's going to be down east, somewhere down there, right? Yeah. So remember that. Next Sunday, we'll be taking up a love offering for Amanda. It was great to have Sunday school this morning in the sanctuary. For those of you who came, we appreciate you coming, and it was good to have the numbers that we had this morning. We're planning on continuing that in the sanctuary as long as the Lord permits through all this stuff that's going on. But we want to let you know that we'd like to have a rotation and give all the teachers who were teaching their respective Sunday school classes before all this stuff happened an opportunity to teach. So if you were teaching before and you're interested in teaching, we want to have just a short meeting Wednesday at 6 o'clock, just before prayer meeting, so we can kind of discuss that and how we would schedule everyone. We'll make out a little, maybe an Excel spreadsheet, and we'll stagger it out. So maybe each person's teaching maybe once a month or once every 6 weeks. So if that's something you would like to do, we would love for you to participate. So just remember that. We'll meet Wednesday at 6 o'clock. Wilma Young wants to let the church know that some flowers blowed off up near Walter's grave, and from another, I guess, another tombstone there that she doesn't know who they belong to. So she has them in her car. So I think that she said that if she is here today, I'm not sure if you're here, Wilma. Oh, there you are. If she's got the flowers today, so if you want them or you know if they're yours or not, see her after church and she'll give them to you. Okay, I think that's all I have. Do y'all have any further announcements that need to be made? No? Okay, come on up.
Good morning, New Hope. I don't know if y'all remember, but a few months ago we mentioned giving out your personal testimony as part of kicking off our vacation Bible school. We didn't get to have it last year. I think a lot of people are missing it. And Reed and I have been talking, and we'd like to put your personal testimony up on our Facebook page, up on our YouTube channel, And even if you don't want to record it, we can also read it out loud during our church service if you're willing to do that. I think it's just a good way to praise God, tell this world how wonderful He is. Amen. He's made all the difference in my life. And this world needs Jesus, amen. Period. And Reed and I are really convicted about this. There's no time to waste anymore. We need to tell the world about what He's done in our lives. So if you would be willing, think about it. Just a 2-3 minute video. It doesn't have to be lengthy. Just be as honest as you can. Let the Lord lead you. Please be praying about it. It can be just as simple as who I was before I decided to follow Jesus. What circumstances helped me decide to follow Jesus, and how my life has changed, and how my life has differed since I decided to follow Jesus. It's that simple. So let's say, for example, my life. I grew up in a loving home, knew I was loved, but I knew that something was missing when I was a child. I had a fear of death. I had a fear of not being accepted. I had a fear of just being alone and where I would go when I died. I wasn't sure. And I'd been to the church all my life and went to Vacation Bible School. My grandparents took me and I loved it. But it was, believe it or not, at a babysitter's house with a bunch of kids that I really didn't get along with, and I really didn't like my babysitter. I really didn't like being there. It wasn't my favorite place. But my parents, you know, let me be there, and I was taken care of. I'm not complaining, because one day we had a conversation about where I would go when I died. And I really did not know. And it just so happened that we had Vacation Bible School that year, and a teacher walked in the room and said, "Who would like to be saved? Who knows that they want Jesus to be their Savior?" And my hand shot up. And I was like, "Yes, somebody asked me." And ever since then, I think I remember skipping and telling everybody and running around the church. And it was at Locust Field. And I was running around the cemetery and telling everybody. And I can tell you with assurance, I am not afraid. I am accepted. I will never be alone. And it's all because of Jesus. He is my friend. He talks to me every day. I talk to Him. I can go to Him for anything and everything. And let's just tell the world that, okay? And it's springtime. Let's start planting seeds. Let's just start sharing the word and the love of God. And you can contact me or Rita. Our phone numbers are in the directory. When you do record your testimony, if you would put it on a flash drive for us, we can get that flash drive to whoever's going to be posting it on those web pages. We'll be sending out letters giving you a little bit of a guidance on if you're not sure how you want to share your testimony. Here's like a little guideline. And we'll also be sending out one call message too this week. So please be praying about that. Please share your story. I think it will honor and glorify God. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Vanjie. Stephen, did you record that? All right, we're good. We already got her testimony now, so we're good. All right. Anyone else have another announcement that they need to make today? If we don't, then choir, it's all yours.
We're going to start in our notebooks, page 79.
It was good to be back up here this morning.
Sun is shining, burning the stars in. don't really realize how much you miss something until it's taken away from you.
That's right.
And I love standing right here today. Mm-hmm. I've missed it. And we can't, as Christian people, let folks take away from us what is God given.
Amen.
Our right to be in here,
right,
to worship God and sing these songs and praise Him. Church is about uplifting the Lord and praising Him.
Amen. Amen.
He's here to give us comfort and grace, but we're here to thank Him for what we get to every day. And this is a blessing. I've been excited all morning to get to stand here and sing again on Sunday morning.
Amen.
And sing these songs that we love so well. It just fills your heart and makes you feel so good inside, and it prepares you for the week, and it just, they're uplifting. We can't let government or people or anybody take away what is God given.
That's right. Amen, brother.
And I thank Him for the opportunity to be back here today.
Yes.
God's joy shall fill my heart. Hallelujah. And then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art.
It sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art.
Lately I've been looking back along these winding roads to the old familiar markers of the mercies I have known. And though it may sound simple, it's more than a cliche. No other words to tell you than to say,
I've been blessed beyond my wildest dreams.
myself halfway through my life, and I can't even begin to count the number of blessings that God's bestowed upon me. And I know if you sit here and you think to yourself about the moments where you just didn't know about something, and I know this year's been scary, but I wouldn't trade it for nothing. I've got a little girl back there, and it may have took COVID to scare her into thinking about what's going to happen, but either way, God used it, you know, and we'll never know why this year went down the way it did. But I'm here to tell you, it doesn't matter if you're sitting in this church house or you're sitting out there in that car. He touched her. He made her sit and ask me questions.
Amen.
And as long as we do what we're supposed to do as Christians, and we come and we listen and we worship and we praise. And for the parents out there struggling, I can tell you it's worth it. Just bring them in here. Just bring them to that door. Do whatever you need to do.
Well, glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, glory.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hey, thank glory. Thank
Amen.
You, Lord.
Tell me a morning
just go on and try and tell me a time he's not been faithful. Tell me a morning his mercies were dear. Tell me a moment that he wasn't able to carry you through. And tell me a day he was less than almighty, when he could not roll back the tide. Child, when you look back, you're gonna find there was never a time, never a time, never a time.
Amen. It's been good to be in God's house already, right? What a blessing. There's never been a time that he's not been faithful. God is good. God is good. I'm so thankful that no matter what happens in my life or your life, if you know him, he's the comforter to be there for you. We can try to comfort one another. Our family can try to comfort us as best we can, but when times get rough, we need the comforter. We need him. And I'm thankful. If you don't know him today, this would be a good day to know him. It really would. Well, we want to take prayer requests now. If you've got something you got on your heart that you want to pray about, now's a good time to mention that.
Gene Reagan. Allison,
Father God, continue to pray for our pastor.
Amen.
Have other objects. Brother Arthur's going to be having a procedure in a week or so if Brother Arthur. Now, because of other objects.
Remember, my mom, she's having some health troubles.
Remember the Johnson family tomorrow.
Amen.
Love some other than the rest.
Amen. Remember that.
Continue to pray for Amanda.
Yes, absolutely.
Remember the Connie Howard family. Remember the Harry Banks family and the Banks girl.
Yes. Thank
you. Harry Banks was a blessing to me over the years. Love that man. Anyone else? Got a few that I need to read from the parking lot, I think, here that says, remember the Kirkland family, and some of these may have already been mentioned. I know that that Danny mentioned Doug Johnson's family, remember them. Pray for Greg Stewart, he's having health issues. Our country, Cameron Vanji family, remember them. Nancy Williams, she's in ICU, remember her. And if there's anything else that y'all think of that we've not mentioned, y'all go ahead and say that now. If not, we'll all come to the altar and pray if you're able and willing. We'd love for you to come. Come at this time. Thank you. Well, we want to thank the Lord for visiting with us already this morning. It's been a great service. If we left the building right now, we could say it's been good to be here. But we're grateful and thankful that Brother David Hall is with us today, and we trust that he brought us a message that we need to hear from on high today. And it's always good to hear him, and it's always a blessing that he's willing to come when we need him to come to our church and preach for us. And brother, you come ahead now. It's good to see you again.
Thank you. Amen. Good to be saved.
Amen.
Thank the Lord. Let me wet the whistle when we get started. I love the good singing we've heard thus far. And most of all, I enjoyed the Holy Spirit. That's what makes me feel welcome every time I come to church. Amen? And I'll tell you this morning, you can sure feel the Lord. And if you can't, you're in a good place. Amen. I kind of don't want to preach this morning. And I got a few friends in here, I think. Amen. But you know what? We're supposed to preach the word, whether they hear or whether they forbear. Amen? And God's word will not return back void. It'll do exactly what it's supposed to do. You may think, well, this may not be for me this morning. Well, you can use it somewhere down your life, for sure. And I like to say it's just good to be saved. Amen. I believe God's people need to get happy once in a while. Get excited and rejoice a little bit because, you know, we rejoice at a race car and a football and a deer and this and that. We need to rejoice about the Lord and what He's done for us. David said this, He brought me out of a horrible pit. Boy, I can relate to that, can't you? He brought me out of a horrible pit, set my feet on the solid rock, put a new song in my heart. Amen. I'll never forget. I'll try to preach here in a minute. But I'll never forget going by the, when it was called the Hop Inn, I had a bunch of old CDs that was worldly, and I just unloaded them right there in the garbage can the day after I got saved. You say, well, a fella asked me, he said, why didn't you just take them to the pawn shop and get you some money? I don't want nobody else listening to that garbage. God makes a change in your life. Amen? He'll make a real change. If you've got your Bibles this morning, this ain't nothing new, but it's needed. In Luke chapter 16, I guess the most dreaded message ever preached, and churches hate this more than anything, I guess, but it's one of Jesus' most popular messages. You got your place, Luke 16. You love the Lord this morning?
Amen.
Amen. Me too. I'll tell you what. Luke chapter 16 and verse 19. If you haven't heard this, where have you been? And if you're tired of hearing this, I believe you need to hit the altar. Amen. Any preacher that don't preach this is not worth a dime. Plain and simple. Starting in verse 19. There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate, full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest the good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. Beside all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Then he said, I pray thee, therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. For I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham said unto him, They have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, Nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, If they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. And that's all we feel like reading. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for this opportunity to stand before you one more time. You know me today. I don't know how to go out or come in without the Spirit's guidance. Father, we pray for the people sitting in this congregation. If there's one lost, they'll get saved today. If there's some saved walking afar off, they'll get back in the fold today. Lord, we can do nothing without you this morning. We pray that you have your hand on this service. Bless your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want to preach a little bit this morning on this. The tale of two beggars. Two beggars. There's a lot of people in this world that we consider beggarly or maybe less fortunate than we are, right? Okay, we'll get into this real quick because I feel like the Lord is wanting to do something this morning. Amen. I've already felt that. We don't want to get in His way. The Bible says this, there was a certain rich man. Now, I want you to notice something. Whether you believe in hell or not is irrelevant. Amen. Just because I can't see some air don't mean it's not there. Listen, God said His Word is the final authority. If there's a heaven, then there has to be a hell. You have to believe this today if you're a child of God. I didn't write the book, God did. It's the final authority for a Christian's life. There is a hell. I want you to notice something about these two men. The first thing that we noticed, they had different lives. Now, God's no respecter of persons this morning. He don't care if you're poor or rich. He'll save you just the same. And let me ask you this morning. Do you know how to go to hell? I'm going to give you the real easy ways to go to hell. Don't do nothing. Just live your life and go on your merry way and disregard God and all His Word and you'll end up there. It's very easy to get to hell. But it's also very easy to get to heaven this morning. It's so easy this morning. He wrote in His Word that even a child could understand the way. Amen. But the Bible speaks about these two here this morning. In verse 19, there's a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. Now they had different lives. This rich man, it said, he fared sumptuously. He was clothed in purple. He had the best that money could buy. Amen. And he fared sumptuously every day. Now, I'm going to confess here just a little bit. Sometimes I get a little bit jealous, don't you? I don't see nobody shaking their head, yes, but you do. Amen. Here you are working and trying your very best to get ahead just a little bit, and you'll see somebody living so evil and wicked, seems like everything they touch turns to gold, don't it? Amen. But this rich man here, and God's not a respecter of him. He had all these things because of God, and yet did not realize it. And the Bible says he was clothed in purple, fine linen, and he was very rich. Now, your money, being rich is not a sign that you're going to hell, but listen, if you covet after and love that thing more than you love God this morning, you've got problems. Amen. You've got problems. Now, this man disregarded God, didn't acknowledge God or nothing of that nature, but he was very rich. God had bestowed some blessings. Whether they're saved or not this morning, God blesses. Would you agree? God blesses this morning. He's not willing that any should perish. He don't care if you're saved or lost. He don't want you to die in your sins this morning. So he gives us this parable of these two. Nothing's wrong with being rich, but there's something wrong with not realizing who's put you in that position. Amen? Nothing wrong with that this morning. He had the best material things, the best that money could buy. Let me read you a verse here in Timothy, 1 Timothy 6 and 5. You can turn there if you want. You don't have to. Listen to this. It says, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth. Now listen to this. Supposing that gain is godliness. Huh? From such withdraw thyself. You know, there's people today that think just because they've got the best, the biggest, the brightest, that God must be on their side. Amen. I hate to tell you this morning, that's far from the truth. They said right there, they suppose that gain is godliness. Listen, if you lose everything for Jesus, you'll start to gain this morning. Amen. If you'll say, here's my pride, here's my arrogance, here's all these things this morning, and acknowledge Him, that'll be gain in your life. Amen. And by the way, Christian, your life's not down here, it's hid with Christ. Amen. But he had the best. And maybe he supposed, because he had the best, that God was on his side. Amen. Verse 20, and there was a certain beggar named Lazarus. First thing you notice right here, it goes ahead and it tells his name. It's Lazarus. Look that name up, and it means God will help. Boy, I like that name, don't you? That'd be a good name to have. God will help. Has he helped you this morning? Amen. Just be the house of God. This is supposed to be the time back that you had your choir. I haven't heard a choir in a long time either. And it's good sounding choir. I like your work. You just need to do more of it. Amen. We need to hear more of it. But here this beggar was, and his name was Lazarus. The rich man, he doesn't even give his name. Amen. You know why? I believe it's this. Broad is the way. Many go in thereat. It's just a common thing to go to hell. Once you get saved, you get a brand new name. Do you know that? It's written, the Bible says, in the Lamb's Book of Life. And listen, Lazarus here was a beggar. And the Bible goes on to say this. He laid at his gate. Whose gate? The rich man's gate. And was full of sores. The beggar didn't even have a home, much less a gate. He had to lay down there and depend on others to sustain him. Right. Amen. How many of you like that this morning? We're blessed, ain't we? Right. Even if you're living in a shack and you've got a little bit of food in the refrigerator and a little old car to drive, you're blessed this morning. There's people today digging through trash cans in other countries. Amen. Starving to death, fly infested. Amen. We're blessed today. And here is Lazarus. He's laying at the gate, full of sores. He couldn't go to the doctor. Hey, the dogs came and licked his sores, the next verse says. Couldn't even afford to go to the physician. Now, that's awful. These two separate lives, one's prospering and doing good, and in our human eyes, that looks like the way we need to go, ain't it? But in God's eyes, it's a whole lot different, wouldn't it? That one is last. One day he'll be first, won't he? Amen? And the Bible says in verse 21, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. They had different lives. You may be poor or rich, but you can still go to heaven or hell. It doesn't change the fact that there's a heaven and a hell. The old saying is, you never see a U-Haul behind the hearse, do you? Some of them think that. Amen. But God says, here's two guys. I want you to realize that one of these two could be the same one you model your life after this morning. Now, I'm not saying go out here and give everything you've got away and be poor or go out here and search for a dollar. But there is a way this morning that we should tread to find, and that's God's way. Listen at the Bible. It says this. He begged for the crumbs. This man was starving to death. We got people in churches that are starving to death, and they've got the Word of God sitting right in their lap. Amen. Deep down, we're just not hungry, are we? Huh? They had different lives for sure. He was unhealthy, sickly. You can go to heaven sick, but you can't go lost. Amen. You can go to heaven poor, but you can't go lost. Amen. You can go to heaven rich, you can't go lost. Amen. Verse 23, or 22. And it came to pass that the beggar died. First thing we saw, they had different lives. Now we're going to look at it. They have different deaths. Amen. There's all kind of dying going on, aren't they? Starvation, murders, all these things going on in our country. Yeah, it's here in our country. But listen, there's really only two ways that you die. Now, you can be killed several different ways, but you only die two ways. Either saved or you're lost. Huh? You can't be in purgatory or nothing of that nature. Listen, to be absent from the body and to be what?
Present with the Lord.
Present Amen. With the Lord. Amen. Listen, once you drop this life here, and you know what? As a feller told me the other day, I'll just stop just a minute. We were eating. He kind of got me under conviction. He said, you preachers are supposed to live to a higher standard. We was joking around and stuff. And I said, yeah, to an extent we are, for sure. But you see this right here? It's the same thing you're made out of. And it ain't going to leave until I get a brand new one. Amen. No matter how hard I try, it's going to be there fighting day and night. Here was Lazarus. Here was rich man. They was in the same body. Was nothing different. Lazarus didn't get in because of what he had. Amen. But listen here. They had different deaths. The Bible says this. And it came to pass that the beggar died. Do you know something this morning? I say this all the time. It's 100% chance you're going to die. Amen? You're going to die. This flesh, this mortal, must put on immortal. One day. It could be today. I don't know. But the Bible says this, and it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. There's something happens at the point of death. Amen. Psalms 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Amen. I'm going through, not into. Amen? But there's something that happens at the moment of death. This soul, the Old Testament, when they gave birth, I believe one of them said her soul was in departing. That means she was dying. There's something inside of you that's going to depart. There's a departure that's coming one day. And listen, all that's going to matter is what you did with Jesus on this side. When the departure comes, friend, I want to know that I've been born again. Amen. It's not no hard thing this morning. It's very simple. Hey, if you'll confess and believe in your heart this morning that God hath raised Jesus up from the dead, death, burial, and resurrection, thou shalt be saved. Amen. Saved this morning. Here's Lazarus. He'd got down at the gate, starving, full of sores. Now, a lot of us would probably try to give up, wouldn't we? But he kept plodding along through his lifetime. And listen to this. And he died, and he was carried by angels into Abraham's bosom. Abraham's bosom, read the study, that's a type of paradise. It was in the heart of the earth, and there's a compartment called hell. Amen. And when in Ephesians 4, Jesus came down, he set captivity free. He took the Abraham's bosom is now in heaven. But there's still a hell, folks. There's still a hell. But he was carried into Abraham's bosom. But wouldn't that be something this morning? To be an old beggar, and here come a big royal angel at the time of departure. Hey, we've been waiting on you. Your ride's here. You don't have to lay at no more gates, amen. You don't have to beg for no more scraps. Don't have to worry about dogs licking. You don't have to lay there and freeze all night long or worry about somebody taking care of you. It's all been paid for. Amen. The day that you close your eyes and the day that you put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, it was paid for. You're no longer a beggar. Amen. No longer a beggar. But there he was. And he said he died, and his body was buried. And it goes on to say this. He was carried, and the rich man also died. He was buried. And they were both, their bodies both were buried, but something that happened at death, one of them was carried somewhere. Amen? And listen. Next verse, it says this, talking about the rich man. They both had died, but they both going to have different lives after death. You know there is a second life? Amen. Job says this, Job 14:4, if a man die, shall he live again? All my appointed days I'll wait till my change. That's departure. Come. Amen. And we know that it's coming sooner for some than others. There's some in the hospitals this morning. But if they're saved, they're not begging for another breath. God's got that took care of this morning. But it says about the rich man in verse 23, and in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Now the beggar was in Abraham's bosom, enjoying paradise. And it sort of stops right there about him. But the Bible goes on and tells us about the rich man. I believe it stops right there about Lazarus because he's paid for, it's done for him, the best has come. But for Lazarus, it's not looking to, I mean, for the rich man, it's not looking too good, is it? It's looking pretty grim and gruesome. It says, and in hell, present tense. Did you know in hell you're going to have a body? Yes, sir. What did he lift up? He had two eyeballs, didn't he? You're going to have a body, folks. It may not be like this one, but you'll have one. Lift up his eyes, being in torments, and he seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And the next verse says this, and he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me. God just showed me something this morning. He goes on to say that send Lazarus that he may dip his finger. There's another body part. In water that he may cool my tongue. There's another body part. You got a body. But he does that, but I was thinking about the crime. I bet he was so thirsty that he could have drunk his tears. Amen? But there was no form of water or moisture there at all. Sounds a little bit like heaven to me in a way. It contrasts one another. When we enter heaven one day, God said, God himself shall wipe all tears. He was crying and there was no tears. Amen. You know the worst kind of crying you can do, and I've been through this once or twice, is when you run out of tears. There's nothing left. That's the deepest sorrow, the deepest hurt. Here he was in that shape. Friend, this morning, hell's not a pleasant place. He was in torments, and he could see Lazarus being comforted all them years he laid at the gate. Now he's being comforted. Now I'm crying. Listen to this. The Bible says this, and he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me. You can pray all you want. Once you get to hell, there'll be no more mercy. Amen. You better do your praying right here to someone who will listen. There's a God in heaven that said, my hand's not short, neither my ear heavy, that it cannot hear, but you and your sins have separated between you and your God this morning. Amen. Old Testament, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. Amen? Sin's a killer. Sin's a killer. Have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I'm tormented in this flame. Either way, folks, heaven or hell, you're going to have a new body. Amen? Eyes, fingers, tongues. You also feel in hell. Amen? Crying is an anguish. It's a release. Crying, torment. The Bible says this is a place of weeping and gnashing of teeth. How many of you men ever hit your finger? Or women. I guess women hit their finger too. Amen. But you'll grit them. You ever stubbed your toe in the middle of the night? Oh, I've hit the floor. And I just grit my teeth. Everything I do, keep them cussing. Amen. I'm telling you the truth this morning. And it just hurts, it's pain. But how would you like to be in that kind of sharp pain all the time? Weeping, wailing, and gnashing of teeth. Being in torments. I heard a story one time. It was about two airplane pilots. They were in this one plane. They took off. It was all good. Weather was good. They were flying fine. Come a storm. Something went wrong, and they went down, and they crashed, and it ejected one of the pilots, And he was laying over there and couldn't move, but he was still alive. The other one was in the plane on fire, but he was pinned in. And you know what he was crying? Cut my legs off. The flames getting closer and closer. Cut my legs off. Amen. Cut them off. And the Bible says this, what would a man give in exchange for his soul? I tell you, when the fire gets pretty close, well, we'll cut a lot of things off, won't we? When you're so desperate in that shape and you see the fire upon you, friend, and it's a burning all around, it's right here. If you're lost this morning, you're going to that place. You need to cut that old man out and get away from that and be born again. Yes, you're going to be like that pilot. The man on the ground could not help him because he could not move. He had to watch him burn and weep and wail and say, cut my legs off, cut my legs off. Couldn't do nothing. Just burn up. That's awful, ain't it? It's awful. That'll be like a day in the park compared to one day in hell. Amen? You say, preacher, you're just trying to scare us. Yes, you need scared. Hell is a scary place. What got me saved? I don't want to go there. Amen. I believe there's a better way. Lazarus did something that struck a nerve in God's eyes that God said today, amen. And he said, I'll take you. I'm going to send an angel to come and get you. Amen. Listen, if we'll follow God and if we're born again this morning, we will reach that city. One of my favorite verses in the Old Testament, in the book of Daniel, those three Hebrew children, they wouldn't be in bow or burn, and they bound them up, and they got them in their clothes. They put clothes on them that would burn and burn hot. Amen. And the guards that led them up to the pit, you know the story. It was so hot that the guards were incinerated, but the men did not burn. And the Bible says this, upon whose body, boy, I like this, the fire has no power. That's good this morning, folks. Since I got saved, the fire has no power this morning. Has no power over me. I'm fireproof because I'm saved this morning. Listen, you may not like this. I don't care. I can't go to hell if I want to. I'm saved. You can't unsave a saved person. That's God's salvation at its finest, friend. If you could unsave it, you could save it, which you can't this morning. God's greater than we are, amen. I'm telling you what, if you're lost this morning, I bet you're miserable right now. If you're out of God's will, I bet you're miserable. This is one of the hardest messages to ever preach. People hate this. You know, when you get to hell, you've heard people say, when I get there, I'll just party and live it up. You will not. First of all, you'll be in outer darkness. You won't be able to see nobody. You ever seen a black flame? Amen. It's going to burn so hot. And you'll hear weeping. Well, I'll be down there getting drunk. There's no beer there, folks. Amen. There ain't even no water there. You're going to burn, and you're going to burn good. And you've seen these little cartoons on TV about the devil and his pitchfork and hell. That's not even in the Bible. The devil don't want to go there either. Amen. He's going to be cast into that place. You say, I don't want to go or be with the devil. He's going to be in torment just like you. Amen. Revelation says, day and night, the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. That's awful, ain't it? That's awful. Lazarus was in Abraham's bosom. The rich man died and was buried. And he was crying out, have mercy on me. Thirsty. Here Lazarus was hungry on this side, Now the rich man's thirsty on that side. And Jesus said this, blessed are ye when ye hunger and thirst after righteousness, for ye shall be filled. Amen. And verse 25, but Abraham said, son, talking with the rich man, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. They had different lives after death. Now I want you to notice something. Here the role is reversed. That's where I got my title, The Tale of Two Beggars. They were both beggars. One just did not realize it. When he got into hell, that rich man, what was he doing? Have mercy! Begging. Have mercy! Send Lazarus that he may dip his finger in water and cool my tongue. I'm tormented in this flame. I'm begging you, Lord. But you know what? Once you enter hell, it's too late. See, folks, right here, you got a chance. You can get saved and talk to God. Once you get down there, you can't do nothing. How would you like to be in a place where you could never get out? There's a man one time, and I don't believe in nothing like dreams or stuff. Some of that stuff's silly. I know people have crazy dreams eating pizza and stuff before bedtime. Amen. And I don't put no stock in no dream. But there's a man one time, he said he dreamed that he'd went to hell. And the worst part about it was not the flames and all that, but he could see a clock on the wall. And you know what was the bad part? No hands. Forever and ever. One preacher said, if only a million years, I'd never preach on it again, because there'd be a day you could get out. But it's forever. It's eternal. It don't quit. It don't quench. The Bible says there's fire in hell. Guess what? There's fire in hell. He says there's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth and outer darkness. That's what it is, folks. Now listen, I came with this message this morning. You should rejoice and be happy because you're not going there. The only reason that you can't get excited over a message like this, maybe you're not right with the Lord. But if you're right with the Lord, you'll be like those three Hebrews. It has no power. Preach on. I'm not going there this morning. I'm going to a different place. At the moment of death, friend, when you close your eyes and you leave this body, there's going to be a departure like you've never headed out before. Hey, I went on vacations and the best part was coming back home. Amen. You know, we were come from God, and if you get saved, you'll go back to God. Listen, the best part of this trip down here is I'm going to get to go back home, amen. And it may not be too long from now. The way the world's shaping out and people's acting nowadays, and the devil's loose and he's running rampant in our countries and our nation. Listen, it can't be too much longer before God steps out on that cloud and says, come up hither, amen. And I'll tell you what, when you drop this body, the first time you look on him, some of you that's sitting there like a knot on a log, you're going to shout like you've never shouted before, bless God. And you're going to raise your hands and praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords the way he deserves for saving you from a hell. Amen. 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 Preacher, you're just too nutty. You need to get saved. God's been too good to me. Verse 25, I'm trying to hurry and get through this. Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receiveth the good things, likewise Lazarus evil things. Now he's comforted, thou art tormented. Amen. And beside all this, verse 26, Between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from thence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Once you get there, it's fixed. You see that word in that verse? Fixed. It can't be unfixed. It's fixed. You can't pray your way out. You can't. Your family can't throw enough money in the offering plate to the priest and say, pray him out. That won't work. It's fixed. Well, there was two women there serving Jesus, Mary and Martha. One of them was cumbered about with much serving. And you know what Jesus said about the other one? He said, Mary has chose that good part. I'm so glad that I chose the good part. Amen. We can get wrapped up in this world and the cares of this life and forget about what God has really done for us and where He's brought us from. Once you get to hell, you notice something about fire. People at camping, I did it, you've done it. We build a fire, we'll sit there and look at that thing for hours, don't we? And it's just an amazement. And you'll see them little blue flames flickering and red and orange. But listen to this. There's fire in hell. It'll never be put out. But that fire, you can take fire, and if you got an old dirty knife or something, stick it in there, and it'll kill every germ and thing on that blade, won't it? What are you saying? Fire purifies. God's going to purify this place one day. If you're lost, He's going to put you in a place where you'll never spread any more infectious sin ever again. Amen. That's hard, ain't it? Lazarus, he was in Abraham's bosom, enjoying those good things. Roles are reversed. Now the rich man's begging. Listen to what he says, and I'm about done. Verse 27, then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. Sounds like more begging to me. For I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come to this place of torment. One of the worst things of hell, you're going to remember the life you lived. Even around his family, he lived such a bad life, they didn't get to come to Christ. Amen? Wouldn't that be awful? Not just me down here, but there's nothing I can do for them now. And the way I lived, maybe you was a big brother or a big sister and they followed you in your footsteps, they're falling headlong right behind you. He said, Father, send somebody that may warn them. Listen, you've got preachers, we've got good singing, we've got all the Bible today, it's warned us. Let me tell you something this morning, I believe the Spirit should move and you should get saved. But the day Jesus Christ died on the cross, that's the day that He said, whosoever will. Listen, a lot of people is so messed up, they're waiting on a big bang or a big shot, lightning bolt or something of that nature to get saved. And after God died that day, He said, whosoever. That means He's already sent it out. The decree's been signed. That means if you want to get saved, you don't have to wait, folks. He said, come unto me, all you laboring and heavy laden. I will give you rest. There's no rest in hell. And if you're headed that way, you're getting no rest right now. Amen? No rest. For he said, I have five brethren that he may testify unto them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Abraham saith unto them, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, they hear not Moses and the prophets. How many times has people sat under preaching and heard and heard and still not moved? You know what the Bible says about that? Him that hardeneth his neck. Now this is Bible terminology. Being often reproved. That means the Spirit's saying, come, you need to get saved. Being often reproved shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. Once God destroys what I just read, there's no remedy. Amen. So, but while you're here, there's a remedy. His name's Jesus this morning. He can save to the uttermost. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Paul was there. He had been throughout his life. He had been beat. 39 stripes, save one, the Bible says. He'd been stoned. Amen. He'd been shipwrecked a night and a day in the deep. And he counted all this glory for the Lord God. And you know what he said? He said, I am persuaded that neither death nor life shall... Listen, nothing shall move you from your stance in God this morning. If the whole world wants to go to hell, let them go, amen. Warn them, if they go, they go. As for me and my house, we're going home one day, folks. And I want everybody to go with. I came here this morning to tell you there's a way of escape this morning. Hey, there's a lot of things that you can't get out of. If you're in the trial of a murder and you're handcuffed and they've got evidence against you, you probably ain't going to get out of it. But I know a man this morning that can set you free no matter what you've done. He'll set you free at the day of death. You may have to pay for your sins down here, but you'll get to go to heaven. Amen. This man I'm talking about, his name's Jesus. They were on a little boat one morning. I'm done. Or one evening. And the winds were boisterous. The waves were high. And things of that nature. And they were down in the bottom of the ship. Jesus was asleep. He said, carest not that we perish. And he got up on the boat. He said, peace be still. Thou wondered this, what manner of man is this, that even the winds and the seas obey his voice? I'm still wondering the same thing this morning. What kind of man could pull me out of my past? I would have never thought 20 years ago that I'd be standing behind a pulpit. Amen. If it had not been for the grace of God, I'd probably be out there on meth or something right now. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. Amen. And it's not his will that any should perish. The Bible says this, God doesn't get pleasure in the destruction of the wicked. That means if you're lost this morning, piano player, come on. If you're lost this morning and you're wicked as hell itself, God will have no pleasure in letting you die and go to hell. But if you're bound and determined, he'll let you go there. Amen. This rich man, he had it all, but he became a beggar in the next life. Something to notice. You may live 110 years down here. That's very uncommon. That beggar just begged for that amount of time. But that rich man is forever and ever. As she plays something, would you stand with us today? Don't go to hell. Don't go to hell. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Oh, there ain't nothing wrong with a little beer here and there, a little cussing, a little bad way I present myself. Nothing wrong with that. Well, I guess we all sin from time to time. Amen. But if it's a habitual, reoccurrent thing, I believe I'd get a checkup this morning and see if I'd really been saved. It ain't what you said, it's who you believe this morning. I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Death, burial, and resurrection. That's all you have to do, folks. As they play something, you need to use an altar, come on.
Darkness, and I begin to pray. Then Jesus came to me on that faithful day. He said, "Child, I know you're sorry for all that you have done. Just read to me, for I am the one. I am the one who died on the tree. I am the one who will set you free.
Listen, folks, if you know you're saved on your way to heaven, would you raise your hand? All right. That's probably the majority in here. I'm sure there's somebody in here that could be lost. It's a pretty good-sized congregation. Don't let your pride hinder you from going to heaven. Hey, if you're just sitting there, I'm a big man, I can do it all on my own. You cannot do it. You won't get off the ground. Listen, folks, one day we're departing one another. But if you're saved, we'll meet again. That should bring some joy and reconciliation to each one of us. Maybe there's somebody here that's lost. You don't even have to raise your hand. You know who you are. God asked this question to Israel. He said, "Why will you die? Why will you die?" Rhea and I wouldn't. I would get what I need from the Lord. Maybe you're saved today. Preacher, I'm saved. I'm reading my Bible. I'm doing all I can for the Lord. But there's something going on in my life that's not right, and it's hindering my spiritual walk for the Lord. You know who can help you this morning? Jesus. Jesus. As they play another verse, if you need to come, please come. I'm begging you. I'll be the beggar. Please get saved. I don't want to see you in hell, folks. I've read too much of that book to know it's not a good place. This ain't just something we come and do on Sunday and Wednesdays. This is a reality. Listen, your shoes could be on the morgue shelf tonight. Then what? That old tree that falls down. Listen, whichever way that thing falls, you need to trust the Lord this morning. He's already did the bidding and the calling. If you're saved and want to get closer to the Lord, just when do. Go ahead and sing.
When I'm down in the valley, can't see.
Pray, church. Trying to follow the Lord. There's nothing I can do or say to make you come. But when the Lord speaks to your heart, that's when you need to move. You say, well, I don't know if it's Him. Now, I want to tell you something. The devil ain't wanting you to do nothing for God. So if you feel like you need to come, you better come. That's the Lord. Don't go home miserable. Go home saying, I've done all. I've finished my course. When you leave this life, I've fought a good fight. I've kept the faith. Amen. Lazarus stayed at the gate. Maybe never had a house, but he stayed the course. Amen. There's a lot to say about that. Just sing one more verse. I'm done.
When I'm down in the valley, can't see the light of day, I look to Jesus, for He is the He says, child, don't be discouraged and don't be afraid. Just know that I am with thee now and always. I am the one who died on the tree.
Quit fighting, church. Pull up that white flag and say, here am I, Lord. Send me.
Lost in darkness, and I begin to pray. Then Jesus came to me. That faithful day. He said, child, I know you're sorry for all that you have done. Just reach
thank the Lord, I'm not going to hell. Amen. Doesn't hurt to give thanks.
I look to Jesus, for he is.
There were 10 lepers there. They were all clean. 9 walked away, and 1 got halfway down the road. And he said, look what the Lord did for me. And he said, he turned around and with a loud voice, he glorified God. I think once in a while you need to glorify God for what he's done for you. Listen, there's no other man like this man. He's did a whole lot for you. Thank the Lord.
Died on the tree.
Church today. I just feel like lingering. I don't know why. I know these long-winded preachers, they give these invitations that take forever. But I believe nothing else. You got a song? Go ahead. There's been a lot of people get saved because of that lingering.
Yes.
Amen. A little girl come to me after church one night. I'd done preaching and walking out the door. Gave a longer altar call, and this spirit was moving. God was drawing. She did not come. Got halfway out the door. She told me, I need to get saved. This might be your last opportunity. No telling how many's died this week. By the grace of God, it wasn't you. But if you're saved, you'll live again. Amen. I can't stress that enough. Go ahead.
Same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, well, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, pain taker. If you feel lost,
yes,
he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. Well, there's a better life.
Yes.
There's a better life. If you got pain,
cast all your cares upon him.
If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains,
a new lady,
he's
come
a
pray
chain
with her.
Breaker.
Yes.
We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. Well, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, well, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. Search for the light of day in the dead of night.
Thank you, Lord. Save my soul, Lord.
We've found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. Well, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. My chains are gone.
Well, I can't leave him, don't you?
He's a chain breaker. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Thank you, brother, for that message.
Thank you. All right, saved by the grace of God, brother. Thank you.
Amen. Bless your life. Bless your heart.
What's that young lady's name? Kaylee? Well, Kaylee made headlines in heaven just now. Says there's rejoicing in the presence of angels.
Yes, amen.
Over one sinner that repented. I showed her the plan of salvation. She says, are you saved? She's saved. Praise the Lord today. That was worth this service this morning. To see one saved.
Amen.
Listen, I'm so glad that God works in mysterious ways. As I was just sitting here thinking, God, I didn't do worth a darn this morning. But it ain't about Dave anyway. It's all about God. And I'm glad he can save this morning. He's able. He's able. Amen. Amen. I don't know what to do yet. It scares me when it's like that. I don't know what God wants. Anybody got anything on your heart?
I'm I'm glad
eating
the Holy Manna this morning.
Amen. 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 Anybody got something on your heart?
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. If not, Miss Kaylee, would you come up here? And I'm not your pastor, but I'm sure he'd say the same thing. Let's everybody come around after we dismiss. Well, wait a minute.
We
got another one here this morning.
Hey.
Yes, amen.
Thank you, God, for his holy spirit. God, for your goodness, God, the heart of these young people. God, we pray, God, your hand be upon them, God, and give them the strength. God, give them the will, God, to do your precious holy will. Your obedience, God, the divine leadership, the Holy Spirit. God, for your God, your obedience. This morning, as he bows before you, every morning, you know, God, you're grateful, man. You can get your regular meeting, God, and Lord, you are in the glory, God. We thank God, we stand with your hands.
Now it's been a long, long road, and my soul is grown so weary, I just can't understand the struggles within me. There have been times I've strayed away, even times I could not pray, but some
else. We'll pray for it when we just speak. Anybody else got something on your heart? Well, I don't like to cut God off. He's worked some miracles this morning.
Yes.
Jeremiah 33:3. Call unto me, and I will show thee great and mighty things, which thou knowest not. I'm glad some people called upon him this morning.
Yes.
He showed what he could do. Amen. Anybody got a word this morning? Anything you want to say?
I just want to say that I thank the good Lord for two parents that took me to church, forced me to come to church. But thank thanks be to them and thanks be to the Lord that I am saved and redeemed. And I ain't got to face that place called heaven.
Amen.
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 And I have a loving wife that I know she is in the same position I am.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Let the redeemed say so. Anybody else? All right. We'll dismiss. Brother Bryson, would you dismiss us today and pray for the needs?
Mighty God, again, we bow, God, on unworthy bending knees to thank
yes,
you.
Lord.
Praise you for the presence, God,
thank you, Lord.
Of He, the Holy Spirit,
that's
been
Lord.
In our midst. Thank you for the obedience,
yes,
God,
Lord,
of your people
salvation.
Who bows and calls on the Holy God.
Thank you,
we
thank
know
you,
God is able to meet our needs.
Yes,
God,
Lord.
You know the objects of burden, God, on each and every one.
Yes.
And I beg you, God, for a strength to God, each one that makes up this body of believers. God, that we be in one mind and one accord every time that we assemble.
You,
God, that you'd watch over, you'd guide us, you'd direct us, God, every thought and everything that we do. God, again, we thank you for this service. God, we give you all the glory. We give you all the honor, God, for what you have done here this day. God, I just pray, God, and thank you for your obedience to these who've responded. Help us, God, to do your will. In Jesus' name I ask you. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Kaylee, come up here.